Have you ever heard the phrases bite the bullet or break a leg? They sound painful, but they are idioms in the English language. These interesting phrases, and if you know what they mean, they're really helpful. Let's take a look at 15 of them. So in every culture, in every language, there are interesting phrases that people just know. They don't usually mean what you think they mean. The way that the words are put together comes from some story or historical moment, but now they're used in a different context. And in English, we call them idioms. So here are 15 of them that you may have heard and you may have been wondering, what are they talking about? All right, number one, blessing in disguise. Blessing in disguise. This is something good that actually seemed bad at first. For example, let's say I lose my job. I get laid off from work and I don't have a job anymore. That seems really bad, and it typically is. But then, a week later, I get a wonderful job. It's the job of my dreams. And I wouldn't have found that new job if I hadn't lost the first job and gone out looking. So the new job is so wonderful. So when I lost my first job, it's a blessing in disguise, meaning it was sort of pretending to be a bad thing, but then it turned out to be a really good thing. Number two, a dime a dozen. A dime a dozen. This is something that is very common. For example, let's say we go to a soccer game together and I watch a player and I say, he's really good. My friend may say, no, he's a dime a dozen. What he means is, that player is good, but there are plenty of them that are just as good. Whereas over here, that guy over there is an elite player, the best of the best. But the rest of them are a dime a dozen. It's a phrase that came from long ago, probably in the United States or elsewhere. It essentially means a dime is the 10-cent coin in the United States. And let's say I have a rose, and I think it's a great rose. Well, I might be able to buy a dozen of those roses for 10 cents, for a dime. So it's basically saying they're so common, you can get a lot of them for a little money. So if you think of it in another context, all those soccer players are good, but they're a dime a dozen. You can get, there's a lot of them, but there's only a few of these really special soccer players over here. Number three, beat around the bush. Beat around the bush. I'm not sure how this phrase came to be, but basically it means avoid talking about or doing something that's uncomfortable. For example, if I am speaking to you and I really don't want to talk about how you have been really mean lately, we might have a conversation and I start to tell you a little bit, but I can't really do it. It's very tough. I might beat around the bush. It means that I'm trying to tell you something, but I'm not doing a good job because I'm avoiding it because it's hard to do. And you may say to me, hey, Steve, quit beating around the bush. Tell me what you think. And what they're saying to me then is like, quit avoiding the topic. Just tell me the truth. So beat around the bush means I'm avoiding talking to you about something that is hard to talk about. Number four, better late than never. Better late than never. Let's say you and a friend go to a concert to see one of your favorite musical performers, and the performer is late. Literally, the show was supposed to start at 7 p.m., and it is now 7:15, and everybody is wondering, are they going to show up? Maybe we ought to just go home. Maybe they're going to cancel. But then you find out at 7:20 p.m., they come on stage, and it's great, and the concert was great. You would look at someone and say, well, better late than never. I'm glad that they were late instead of never coming. So you're very pleased that it, whatever you're looking for, whether it was a concert or a game or a person showing up, it was better than be late than never show up at all. Number five, bite the bullet. Bite the bullet. This one does not sound fun at all. I'm not sure where the phrase came from. It doesn't literally mean to put a bullet in your mouth and chew it. That would be painful, and I'd be afraid that it would blow a hole through my mouth. What it means, though, is to go ahead and get something over with because it is inevitable. You're going to have to do it anyway. So, for example, if I needed to go have my knee operated on, I hurt my leg and I know I need a knee operation, but I can do it next week, or I can do it 6 months from now, somebody may say, just bite the bullet and go have the surgery. Just get it over with. And I may think, you know what? I'm just going to bite the bullet, get it done, because I can't avoid it forever. Number six, break a leg. Break a leg. This is another one that sounds really painful, but it doesn't refer to actually breaking your leg. What it means is good luck, or you're going to do great. Go get them. Best wishes. Let's say I have a son who is going to play baseball and he's going up to the bat and I think he's going to go hit a home run. I would say, hey, you can do it. Break a leg. Go for it. And what I mean is good luck. You're going to do great. Number seven, call it a day. Call it a day. This is when you stop something, or you typically stop work on something. For example, let's say I have been in my backyard and I've been cleaning up the bushes and some weeds, and I've been doing it for hours. I may say to my wife, hey, I'm going to call it a day. I'm tired. My back hurts. I'm ready to go inside. I'm going to call it a day. And it basically means my day, or my time period of doing that particular thing, is done. Number eight, cut me some slack. Cut me some slack. This is a really interesting one. I'm not sure what the cutting is. It doesn't refer to scissors. It essentially means be nice on me, or be gentle, or give me a break. In other words, if I was talking to you and telling a story and I made a mistake, and then I made another mistake and you say, boy, you're making so many mistakes, I could say, cut me some slack. I didn't mean to. I misspoke. So cut me some slack means just be patient with me. Please forgive me. Don't be so critical back to me if I do something wrong. Number nine, cutting corners. Cutting corners. This means you're doing something poorly just to go faster or to avoid having to do so much work. Let's say someone is working on your house and they are fixing a problem outside, and you can tell that they're doing it too quickly, they're not doing a good job, they're not doing it the right way. They are essentially cutting corners. It means that they're just speeding up and trying to get it over with instead of doing it the right way or the best way. Cutting corners. Number 10, easy does it. Easy does it. This is a way of saying slow down, slow down. For example, if you were eating so much food at the dinner table so fast and you're piling food in your mouth and I'm afraid you're going to choke, I could say, hey, easy does it. Easy does it. Slow down. Don't eat so fast. So it's just a very simple way to say, take it easy. Easy does it. Number 11, get out of hand, or getting out of hand. This one doesn't really refer to your hand. It basically means that something is getting out of control. It's getting out of control. For example, let's say my two sons are wrestling and they're having fun and they're being playful, but then they start to get more intense and one of them starts to get a little bit too aggressive, and before I know it, they're fighting and yelling at each other. I may say, hey boys, this is getting out of hand. You all settle down and quit fighting. So when I say get out of hand, I mean it's getting out of control, and it may have started sort of fine, but then it got bad. So I'd say, hey, this is getting out of hand. Or I may look at my wife and say, hey, their wrestling is getting out of hand. Let's stop them. Number 12, get it out of your system. Get it out of your system. This is an interesting way to say, go ahead and do the thing you've been wanting to do just so you can move on. For example, let's say you've been talking about traveling the world. You want to go to multiple countries and you've been talking about it for years and you don't really feel that you can settle down and maybe get a home and a job until you've traveled a little bit. Somebody may say, listen, you need to get it out of your system. Just go travel the world, see the world, and then you'll be ready to settle down when you're back. So get it out of your system basically means think of it as like, you know, eating or drinking something. You're just sort of doing it and you're getting it over with, whether it's something that you've really wanted to do for a long time or you just really felt you need to do. Number 13, get your act together. Get your act together. This means to work better, do something better, or just quit or just leave. So if I have a coworker who has been working on these documents that they need to provide to me and they're just not doing a really good job, I could say, listen, you need to get your act together, or just stop, or just leave. Do your job, get your act together. Now, it is a bit of a mean or harsh thing to say to someone, But sometimes people need to hear it. So I say, hey, get your act together and please do better. 14, give me the benefit of the doubt. Give me the benefit of the doubt. This means to trust me, to trust what I say. So if I told you that I went jogging every day for the past week in the morning for 3 miles, and you say, you know what, I don't know that I believe you. You've never been that big into exercise. How did you do that? I could say, hey, give me the benefit of the doubt. Trust me, I've been doing that. I've been getting into exercise. And essentially what I'm saying is, don't doubt me. If you could believe me or not believe me, give me the benefit of the doubt and go ahead and believe me in this case. And number 15, hang in there. Hang in there. This means don't give up. In fact, I congratulate you for watching this far in the video. You hung in there. You didn't give up. You've made it to number 15 of these idioms. It essentially means don't quit. So if I have a friend of mine who has been trying to find a job for months and months, and he's right about to give up and he's feeling so bad, I may say, hey, don't give up. Hang in there. Hang in there. You're doing great. So well done. Those were 15 idioms in English, very common phrases that we use in day-to-day speech. A lot of times for most people, we don't know where they came from. We're not exactly sure how they came to be, what the history is behind them, but they're pretty interesting. And once you learn them or hear them and use them enough, you don't ever really think back to the original terms. In other words, when I say break a leg to someone, I'm not thinking about their leg. I'm definitely not thinking about an injury. So I hope these are helpful. Let me know what you think, and I'll be doing more. I've got hundreds of more of these idioms, and they're a really great way to show people that you're getting more comfortable with the English language because you're using these terms that only fluent English speakers will know and appreciate over time. All right, let me know what you think. Leave comments for other videos that I should be doing, any other lessons, and I hope you have a great day. Take care. See you next time.